Hi friends, today we'll be starting our lecture series on thyroid gland, which will include the thyroid gland anatomy. Then we'll be coming up with the classes on physiology, pathology, pharmacology, the medicine part of the thyroid gland and the surgical part. Now, as you can see, the thyroid gland is a shield-like structure. Okay, this is the anterior view of the thyroid gland and this is the posterior view of the thyroid gland. Starting with the thyroid anatomy. The word thyroid is derived from the Greek word thyroides, which means shield-like structure. So if you see, the thyroid gland is actually a shield-like structure. Now coming to the proper anatomy, the thyroid gland is basically divided into two lobes, the right lobe and the left lobe. The right and the left lobe are joined to each other by this structure known as isthmus. The isthmus at some times may give a upward projection, and this upward projection of the isthmus is known as pyramidal lobe. The pyramidal lobe is also sometimes known as the third lobe of the thyroid gland. The thyroid gland in turn is surrounded by a capsule, and this capsule is known as through capsule. Okay, basically there are two capsules in thyroid gland. One is the true capsule and another is the false capsule. Now the true capsule is actually condensation of connective tissue of the thyroid gland. Okay, now next what we are seeing is the false capsule. The false capsule is derived from the pretracheal layer of deep cervical fascia, and this is one of the important MCQ in your exam. So false capsule of the thyroid gland is derived from pretracheal layer of deep cervical fascia. Okay, next, if you remember, another important point to remember here is the pyramidal lobe is sometimes connected to that of the hyoid bone. Okay, it is connected to that of the hyoid bone with the help of fibromuscular bands, and this fibromuscular bands is known as levator glandulae thyroidae. So this is known as levator glandulae thyroid. Okay, next, coming to the extent of the thyroid gland. The thyroid gland extends from the middle of the thyroid cartilage of the larynx, to that of the fourth or fifth tracheal ring. Okay, it actually lies from C5 to T1 vertebra, that is C5, C6, C7 and T1. Again, C5, C6, C7 and T1 vertebra. So, coming to the measurement of the thyroid gland is approximately 5 by 2.5 by 2.5 centimeters and it weighs about 25 grams. Now, one important point to discuss here is the true capsule and the false capsule. This is the true capsule of the thyroid gland. This is the thyroid gland. Okay, and this is the false capsule. Now, in case of thyroid gland, the true cap below the true capsule, there is presence of dense capillary plexus. Okay, so during thyroidectomy, what they do is the thyroid gland is removed along with that of the true capsule so that there is no bleeding. And this is one of the important MCQ. In thyroidectomy, thyroid gland is removed with that of true capsule. Why? Because in comparison to this, we have the prostate gland. The prostate gland also consists of two capsules, that is the true capsule and the false capsule. But the deep cervical plexus, the dense capillary plexuses in case of prostate gland are present between the true and false capsules. Okay, these are the dense capillary plexuses between the true and the false capsules. Hence, in case of prostatectomy, what they do is the true and false capsules are left behind. So, in case of prostatectomy, prostatectomy, through and false capsules are left behind. Whereas in case of thyroidectomy, they remove the gland along with that of the through capsule. Next, coming to the detailed structure of that of the thyroid gland. Now imagine this to be the transverse view of the thyroid gland at the anterior part of the neck, through the anterior neck along the isthmus. Okay, so if you imagine this, as we know, thyroid has an apex, it has a base, it has a lateral surface. Okay, this is the lateral surface here. Then next, it has a posterolateral surface. Next, the medial surface. Then it has two borders. One is the anterior border and then the posterior border. Okay, the posterior border actually separates the posterolateral surface from that of the medial surface. Along with that, we'll now discuss a few important structures. Now, the lateral surface is covered mainly by the sternohyoid muscle, then by the omohyoid muscle, and finally by the sternothyroid muscle. So remember this mnemonic, HOT. Okay, the lateral surface of the thyroid gland is covered by the sternohyoid, omohyoid, and the sternothyroid, along with the anterior border of the sternocleidomastoid muscle. Okay, this is about the lateral surface. Now coming to the medial surface, there are presence of two tubes, that is, one is the trachea and another is the esophagus. Also, there are presence of two nerves along the medial surface. One is the external laryngeal nerve and another is the recurrent laryngeal nerve. Okay, and also there is presence of two muscles. One is the inferior constrictor and another is the cricothyroid. Okay, now you see in this slide, the false capsule on the inner surface appears to be thickened. Okay, here you can see the thickened false capsule in comparison to the outer part. The inner part, the thick capsule is thickened, and this thickened capsule is known as the suspensory ligament of Bury. And this suspensory ligament of Bury connects the thyroid gland with that of the cricoid cartilage. Okay, this was about the medial surface. Now coming to the posterolateral surface, the posterolateral surface is in close connection with that of the carotid sheet. Okay, the carotid sheet consists of the carotid artery, okay, the vagus nerve, the inferior jugular vein, and also the deep cervical lymph nodes. Okay, it is in close contact with that. After this, if you see the posterior border of the thyroid gland, okay, consider this to be the posterior border of the thyroid gland. Okay, it is in close contact with that of the inferior thyroid artery. Okay, so there is presence of inferior thyroid artery along the posterior border. Okay, next, anastomosis of ascending branch of inferior thyroid artery and the posterior branch of the superior thyroid artery also occurs along the posterior border. Also, you can see that the posterior border has glands, that is the parathyroid gland. If you consider this the posterior border, there is presence of the parathyroid glands along the posterior border. Now, before discussing the blood supply of the thyroid gland, I would like to discuss a few points here. Okay, now consider this to be the anterior view of the thyroid gland, this as the lateral view of the thyroid gland. Okay, now coming to the blood supply, if this is the arch of aorta, okay, arch of aorta, the arch of aorta mainly gives rise to three branches. Okay, this is the brachiocephalic trunk, right? This is the brachiocephalic trunk. Next, it also gives rise to the left common carotid. Next, it gives rise to the left subclavian artery. Okay, now the brachiocephalic trunk further divides into two branches, the right subclavian and the right common carotid. And this right common carotid further divides into the external carotid and the internal carotid. Similarly, the left common carotid divides into the external carotid and the internal carotid. Now, starting with the blood supply, the thyroid gland has its main blood supply from the external carotid artery, okay, through this branch called as the superior thyroid artery. This superior thyroid artery, if you remember, is in close relation with that of the external laryngeal nerve till it reaches the gland. But as it reaches the gland, it goes away from the thyroid gland. Okay, so this is the external laryngeal nerve. Okay, this is the superior thyroid artery. Now, coming to the inferior thyroid artery, the inferior thyroid artery is derived from the thyrocervical trunk, okay, of the right and left subclavian artery. The inferior thyroid artery moves upwards, then goes medially and then downwards to reach the lower border of the thyroid gland. Okay, so this is the inferior thyroid artery. This inferior thyroid artery at the lower border of the thyroid gland is in close relation to that of the recurrent laryngeal nerve. Okay, now why it is important we'll discuss. If you see here, the lateral surface of the thyroid gland, okay, if this is the superior thyroid artery, okay, on reaching the upper border divides into the anterior and posterior part. If you see the close relation of the external laryngeal nerve, the external laryngeal nerve till it reaches the upper border is in close contact with that of the superior thyroid artery. But on reaching close, as it approaches the thyroid gland, it moves away. Okay, this is important during ligation of the thyroid superior thyroid artery, and hence superior thyroid artery is ligated close to the thyroid gland. And as you saw in case of inferior thyroid artery, as the inferior thyroid artery reaches the lower border of the thyroid gland, it comes in close relation to the recurrent laryngeal nerve, and hence the inferior thyroid artery is ligated away from the thyroid gland to prevent injury to the recurrent laryngeal nerve. And this is an important MCQ, that superior thyroid artery is ligated close to the thyroid gland, whereas inferior thyroid artery is ligated away from the thyroid gland. This is to prevent injury to the external laryngeal nerve. Superior thyroid artery is to prevent injury to the recurrent laryngeal nerve. Okay, so if you see the posterior surface, it is again here we are seeing the superior thyroid artery, the anterior branch, the posterior branch. If you see the recurrent laryngeal nerve, it is in close proximity, but it moves away. But if you see the inferior thyroid artery, as it moves towards the thyroid gland, it comes in close connection with the recurrent laryngeal nerve, and hence superior thyroid artery is ligated close to the thyroid gland, inferior thyroid artery is ligated away from the thyroid gland. Okay, finally discuss the venous supply of the thyroid gland. The thyroid gland drains mainly via the superior thyroid vein, the middle thyroid vein and the inferior thyroid vein. Okay, the superior and the middle thyroid vein mainly drain into the internal jugular vein, okay, and the inferior thyroid vein drains, okay, so this drains into the brachiocephalic vein. Okay, another, there is a fourth vein between the middle and the inferior thyroid vein sometimes in few patients, and this is known as the vein of Kocher, which also drains into the internal jugular vein. Now we are remaining with the lymph node. Okay, the lymph from the thyroid gland, the upper part of the thyroid gland, drains into the upper deep cervical lymph nodes, whereas the lower part of the thyroid gland drains into the lower deep cervical lymph nodes. Okay, this was all about the anatomy of the thyroid glands. Do subscribe and like our YouTube channel for many more such videos. Thank you.